The only band to emerge at CBGB who could truly claim to be from New York was the Ramones. Their garage sound heralded a return to classic rock and roll that would ultimately transcend CBGB and New York to take the world by storm.
The Ramones was basically a concept that sort of developed in my head after I saw the New York Dolls. And saw how entertaining they were, even though they weren't virtuoso musicians. They were like very exciting because they put on a good show. And to me, it seemed like, I mean, at this time, everybody was a virtuoso musician. That was the thing. You know, it started, of course, with Jimi Hendrix and Eric Clapton and stuff like that. Everybody was just noodling away and everything. And I thought it was time for a change. And we wanted to go back to the 2-minute song, which with us was like more like a minute and a quarter.
They were like, you know, paratroopers descending, at, you know, or like they're like the SWAT team plunging through the plate glass windows. You know, it was just very effective always.
I mean, for me, the Ramones kind of created a template of punk rock that would be known as punk rock.
Punk was originally the name of a New York fanzine set up in 1976 to highlight the underground downtown rock scene. Punk as a musical idea would be truly realized later in another city across the Atlantic, but the word was first applied to bands playing at CBGB.
I don't know if Talking Heads really qualified as a punk band, but we thought of ourselves as artists who happened to be musicians and we felt like we really had a strong connection with bands like the Ramones and bands like Television and Patti Smith, but I don't think they really thought of themselves as punks either.
You start a conversation and you can't even finish it. You're talking a lot, but you're not saying anything when I have nothing.
Whether they were punk or not, one thing was for sure. Very few of the CBGB bands could get a record deal.
For me, the record labels took a while to figure it out down there because it was out of their realm of knowledge. They didn't quite know what to do with these bands. They sounded different than most of the groups that were selling on the radio. And sometimes when your head is in the clouds, you don't see what's happening down by your feet. You have these huge corporations, and yet 30, 40 blocks downtown, there's a kind of excitement and a new thing, but it takes a while for it to filter up.
Johnny, it's a feeling. And in the Patti Smith Group's case, it would be a Midtown major label Arista who would sign them and team the band up with producer and godfather of the downtown scene, John Cale.
It was a band that had never been in the studio before. And it was a band that also had really worked themselves up from nothing. And very carefully.
It definitely was like working with a hero, but the nice thing about John is that he's quite a human being. And he's a funny guy and as flawed and as ecstatic as we all are. And so, once we got down to the actual working, we found our rhythm. Some of it was very confrontational.
When we went into the studio, everybody was probably playing their first instruments. There was the first guitar ever owned, first keyboard ever. And we ran into problems because they were warped and had all sorts of problems. So I called up SIR and said, hey, send over a couple of guitars, send over a keyboard, and it really upset the apple cart.
The result of the tense collaboration would be the classic album Horses, whose poetic ambition and return to three-chord rock and roll would be a war cry to a new generation and put punk on the global map. What had been created downtown had eventually been assimilated in Midtown New York and served up to the world. And in 1977, Exactly the same thing would happen to disco, which had left its downtown roots far behind. Set in New York, the movie Saturday Night Fever exported disco mania worldwide. And in the affluent heart of Manhattan emerged the ultimate club.
Studio opened in 77, the end of 77, and the opening night was huge and fantastic.
This is where you'd see Bianca Jagger in all her glory, or, you know, or David Bowie for that matter, or Iman, or Diana Ross, and all of Halston and all the designers. Women was very, very, you know, extreme makeup, hair really done up, huge platform shoes. You know, it was disco.
Studio 54 was the brainchild of enterprising businessman Steve Rubell.
Steve really worked on getting it in the paper every day and having these little, like Bianca's birthday party, which happened almost within the first month we were open, and which I played for, where she came in on this white horse, and in the middle of the New York Daily News the next day, there were all pictures of Bianca Jagger on this white horse, and the Bee Gees were in town at the Madison Square Garden, and the Bee Gees got this much coverage, and Bianca got this much coverage. So it was really like a weird time, like people were very into this kind of scene and exposing it.
It's difficult to know what it is exactly that attracts people here. All that one can be absolutely sure of is that it isn't the conversation. Norman Rees, News at 10, at Studio 54 in New York.
Studio 54 to me was really no different than what I was seeing in punk. It was because it was the same freshness. It was when I walked into Studio 54, I walked to the edge of the dance floor, and all this white powder was falling from the ceiling, like snow, but obviously the image was really coke. And these frenzied people were dancing, and there were all these fascinating people standing around talking to each other. I just was in another room with people who were really alive and really there.
It felt really magical. At the risk of sounding corny, if you got into studio, you belong. And if you belonged in studio, you were an interesting person and everybody treated you that way. I remember just, you know, anybody that you got into a conversation with, it felt like it was more interesting. It felt like you were talking to Truman Capote, and you actually could be talking to Truman Capote. You felt like you were talking to intellectuals. You felt like you were talking to artists, people who were gonna have some sort of impact on the world.
Precisely in a downtrodden city, glamour means an awful lot. And glamour was really what that place was about. It was a place where you felt like, I have arrived in the city and some weird level, I have access to it.
Well, it kind of worked for me because I ended up giving two soldiers a blowjob out on the balcony one night after doing about two bags of coke.
It was, you know, a fascinating place. There's a ground floor and the famous dance floor. But, you know, if you weren't in the lower, the real action was in the balcony. Because there weren't seats. There was just these, you know, people would be making out, people would be fucking, people would be doing drugs. It just felt really, it did feel decadent.
But, you know, the balcony was where people went to get blowjobs anyway. Everyone gave blowjobs up on the balcony at Studio 54. That's what you were supposed to do. You have to remember, in those days, before AIDS came along, sex was rampant. It was like people had sex like the drop of a water. And, of course, a lot of people had to pay for it. But that's what it was like. That's what it was like.
Within 6 months, Studio 54 had earned a reputation for being a midtown Sodom and Gomorrah. And suddenly, everybody who was anybody wanted to be there.
And so Steve started getting all this press, and all of a sudden, there's lines around the block at Studio, and he decides to do this kind of, you know, you, not you, you, if you take your shirt off and you lose your girlfriend, and it, just all these things that were really, I thought, very rude, very, very rude.
Oh, you're not shaved, there's no way in hell you're going to get in. It doesn't matter, you're not shaved, listen, just go home.
Studio was the antithesis of what most people at the beginning felt disco was about. It was certainly not at all democratic.
Studio 54 turned the all-inclusive, music-led ethos of the downtown club scene on its head, selling exclusivity to the privileged few. For those without the keys to the city, the more they were turned away, the more they wanted to come.
We went down to Studio 54, and we were sure that Grace Jones had our name on the list. You know, she was like the queen of disco, or queen of clubs. And, you know, we get there, and we try to get in. You know, Chic. Chic who? You know, Chic. And we try, you know, everybody's hands are not happening in Studio 54. You know, Chic, you know, yowza, 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 dance, dance, dance. Well, I don't see your name here on the list. New Year's Eve is a heavy night at Studio.
You turn away enough people, there starts to be a real backlash against you. Even not just people talking bad about you, but energy-wise, people are thinking, that guy sucks, that club sucks.
And like the good, you know, ex-revolutionary and former Black Panther that I was, the first thing I thought of was writing a protest song. So I started jamming on this groove. And then Bernard, you know, just came right in. And we start grooving. And then so, I don't know what made me do it, and I just went, fuck off, because it was just right.
Nobody Black or anybody I knew were able to get into Studio 54. They would just block off the whole block, so that was just like, you know, so. It was a severe hatred for Studio 54. It was like, you know, fuck them, man. Really. I hope it burns down.
For millions of New Yorkers not fortunate enough to belong to the city's elite, the glamour of Studio 54 and the bohemian atmosphere of CBGB were a far cry from the reality of the streets.
New York City in the middle of the 70s was a rough looking place. You talked about there was corruption inside government. There was a problem with fiscal spending. And there was always a distrust of the mayorship around that time. So you had services in New York City that were limited. And the first areas that felt that the limited services were the areas where Black and Hispanic people were living. Thus, you know, Uptown, Brooklyn, and the Bronx were having a rough time at it and kind of like dipped into the realm of being slums.
Well, I mean, this is a long history. It goes back to when they built the Cross Bronx Expressway. Robert Moses, who was a giant builder, had this mandate that even superseded that of the elected officials to build what he felt was necessary. And it was a big construction project that went through the Bronx, and it really split the area apart. It went right through the heart of the South Bronx. It disrupted the neighborhoods on either side. And the area never quite recovered from it psychologically. The sense of cohesion was lost.
Go! The South Bronx resembled a war zone. Buildings that hadn't been demolished were torched by insurance-scamming landlords desperate to get out, and a citywide blackout in 77 served only to enhance the atmosphere of lawlessness.
Like right here, up and down the climb, a lot of these stores never came back on that blackout. People came through and they started looting, breaking the windows, you know what I'm saying? Crashing bottles and just taking everything at sight. That's what it was in 77. That blackout was crazy. I think the South Bronx suffered more from that blackout than any other four boroughs.